privilege under the call upon them to speak. Richard Griffiths, the longtime, only very recently retired senior editorial director for CNN. Richard is now the professional in residence at the University of North Carolina School of Media and Journalism. I'm going to ask each of our panelists to play doctor for us tonight, starting with you, Dr. Griffiths. We're all sick of fake news. We're sick of being sick of fake news. What's your diagnosis and what's your prescription?
It's not fatal. In fact, it's been around a long time. I'm going to read a little quote here. Nothing can now be believed which is seen in a newspaper. Truth itself becomes suspicious by being put into that polluted vehicle. That was Thomas Jefferson. Right? I mean, there was a time where the printed press came along and all these broadsheets came out and all of this rubbish was printed and published and put out there. And all these politicians were dealing with these broadsheets and these flyers that went out. The difference is that today, the stuff that's being published, you saw it here on the screen, looks so similar to legitimate sites. What was a broadsheet with limited circulation, perhaps of 500 or 1,000 copies in one city, is now seen globally by tens of thousands of people. And it gets forwarded to you by your mother-in-law and by your cousin Vinny. And with that comes the imprimatur of the credibility of your relative. I want to look at this on a global perspective, and if I can go to the...
Fast forward to my...
Yes.
Giving it away.
There we go. So Edelman does a public relations survey every year. It's an amazing, amazing survey. They survey 22,000 people worldwide, which gives them a margin of error of 0.6% globally. That's a really, really good survey. And what they've found is that trust in all the four major institutions, NGOs, business, government, globally, all dropping, but media dropping the most, down 5 points last year to this year. That is a huge fall off the cliff. If I'm Dr. Griffiths, this is the diagnosis that you get from the MRI when you're thinking, we need to have a private chat. Right? This is tough. If you look at it all across the globe, trust in media almost universally is below 50%. Distrust in 82% of the countries. Fascinating for me, because I worked at CNN for so long, and I don't know whether this is because of CNN or because CNN's management are incredibly smart, is that the countries where trust in media is improving, Turkey, Sweden, India, and Indonesia, are all countries where CNN has launched partner broadcasters or partner news platforms where they've brought in really high journalism standards and generally raised the quality of journalism in those countries with a trusted brand. Whether that's a coincidence or whether that is perhaps a part of that brand identity where they made a big splash, I'm not clear, but there's some small chunks. Still, only 25% of Turks trust the media. Right? Those numbers are still really, really tiny. In Sweden, up 2% with Aftonbladet joining as a CNN partner, 33% trust in the media. Still pretty dismal. And if you look at which forms of media fall in, traditional media shows the steepest decline. You've got the biggest trust is in search engines, which is actually up. People trust Google and Bing more than they trust CNN and the New York Times. That's scary, frankly. And then this is a huge issue here. This is between what I would call the mass population, the educated, informed public. You would probably, everybody here would probably be in the informed public group, at which globally 60% trust the media institutions, whereas the mass population, only 45% trust. So a big gap between the educated and the less educated. Finally, this says it all, Michael Gove. I don't think I can do a good Michael Gove accent, but I can try. People in this country have had enough of experts. Right? This is the situation. The most critical are people like yourself. Your mother-in-law, your cousin Vinny. And then down here, the government official, boards of directors, CEOs, financial industry analysts, employees, academic experts, they're down 5 points, sorry. You can trust them, really. But this is the scary scenario that we're seeing, where you have an environment where the junk is flying around. It looks like legitimate stuff, and it's coming to you from people you trust. And that's the underlying issue that we're facing. Just this one more example that just continues to drive me crazy. This is from the day of the election. Excuse me, this is November 8th. Election day. And this was, Nevada poll workers were caught breaking the law today. Several of the poll workers in the CNN report were wearing defeat Trump t-shirts. And we were getting harassed in the ground in Nevada by people. Why aren't you reporting this? This was hundreds of thousands of retweets and shares. The problem was that this was a story done by one of our reporters the Friday before the election, and these were actually Clinton workers in a Clinton boiler room making calls to get out the vote. And so it was completely repurposed. This organization, Gateway Pundit, now has a place in the White House press room. So that gives you some idea of what kind of crisis we're now facing. So some of it we brought on ourselves. As an industry, we've failed to adjust to the new technologies. Newspapers have been slow. I would include CNN in being slow. I would include many organizations in being slow. And CNN's been on the cutting edge of dealing with so much of this technological change. We've been arrogant about acknowledging and correcting our mistakes. I'm proud to say at CNN we were open and transparent about our screw-ups, and God knows there were plenty over my tenure. If you look at others, you look at Fox News, for example, I have to call them out here. It took a lawsuit to get them to correct their last big screw-up. We have not, as an industry, been sufficiently clear about our journalistic processes and how we get to produce the particular stories, how we gather the news in a way that you as an audience can understand and trust.
How we filter it,
how we build things out. By the way, this is the amazing Bob Fernand with us tonight, the extraordinary senior executive producer and vice president of CNN during his glory years of development, a giant in the industry, and it's really happy.
Here's the smart one.
We've not been sufficiently clear about what is reporting, opinion, and analysis. And a small thing is, who can explain to me what a ragged right edge in a story in the New York Times means? Anybody know what that means on the website, where it's got a ragged edge as opposed to a justified edge? Oh, that's an analysis piece. or it might be, right? So it's hard to pick that stuff out. They mark it And they give you clues, but you have to know and be able to decode it. And we're not doing enough to make it truly clear the difference between an analysis piece, an opinion piece, and straight reporting. And so often on so many websites, the lead story will be an analysis piece. So you'll have a big breaking news story, and then you'll have analysis, and you're saying, well, you're taking the president to task, we haven't even heard what he said yet. So the sum of that is an issue for our industry. And I don't think we have fought back adequately against the fake news monster. We've not done enough, in my view, to call out the crappy work, the fake stories, and publish knockdowns of those stories. And that, frankly, requires a lot of resources. And if you're pedaling the bicycle as fast as you can to get down the road covering the news of the day in your community, diverting resources to go look at somebody else's work is very expensive, very hard, but I think we have to do it, and we have to figure out how to do it well. So one more thing from Jefferson. Were it left to me to decide whether we should have a government without newspapers or newspapers without a government, I should not hesitate a moment to prefer the latter. You know, during the debates, CNN put an enormous team together to do the reality checking of those debates and feed that stuff back to not only the anchors, but also to do the immediate after the debate reality checks. The amount of effort that went into that and chasing down every detail and coming up with backup to do that was 30 people up till 4 in the morning on debate nights. And I would get in just dragging my sorry rear end and then have to get up the next morning to get back in the office for that 9 o'clock editorial meeting. That's the logistical challenge you have in an environment where the claims come fast and furious and the ability to keep up is really difficult. That was an exaggerated moment because so many of them came during the debate on both sides. To do that on an ongoing basis for a news organization is a monumental commitment of time and resources, which a lot of organizations like the New York Times, keeping its track, are doing, but for the little paper in Conyers or the television station in Atlanta, it becomes really difficult because they don't have the resources to do that. And that's a huge challenge to what you guys. For those of you who didn't go to journalism school, there's a theory about the layers of journalism. It was originally put out there by Melvin Melcher, who was a professor from Long Island who went to work at Columbia. And I actually use it a lot within CNN and have expanded on it a lot. I won't give into my 1 hour lecture on this, but the three basic concepts are, layer one journalism is what you learn from the news release, the news conference, the police blotter, a train wreck has occurred, a plane has crashed, the basics that a story occurred. Layer two journalism is holding the officials accountable for what they said in the news conference, what they said in the tweet, why did the plane crash, what are the underpinnings of the story. Then layer three is analysis and opinion. Well, it's very easy to have an opinion. I don't want to fly Thunderbolt Airlines because they fly old planes. That politician is corrupt and you see it here in this reporting. Well, layer one and layer three are very easy for social media to do. Anybody can forward a tweet based on what the president has said or forward a news conference, and it's easy for the officials to go over the public. It's very easy to do the analysis and opinion. Anybody in their pajamas can do analysis and opinion. But serious journalism, that layer two enterprise reporting where you're doing accountability journalism, is really hard, requires a big investment. And that's where great news organizations thrive. And for the news organizations that fall back on the opinion and just doing the layer one reporting, that's where we're losing our credibility with the public. In order to maintain that credibility, you've got to really drill down on that enterprise reporting where you're challenging and holding accountable.